Hello, everyone. This is Neil Caden from the Apereo Foundation, and we're here today to introduce course timetabling with Unitime. And this session will be recorded. It is Wednesday, October 14th, and it will probably take a few days to get up on YouTube, and then we'll share so that the community can review. I'd like to introduce Susanna and Tomas, who are presenting today, and I'll turn it over to them.
Thank you, Neil. My name is Susanna. I've been working on and with Unitime for a relatively long period of time. And today I would like to have a presentation about course timetabling with Unitime. Unitime does more than that. We will cover it, but today is focused on that, on course timetabling. Then if we have time, Tomáš will continue sharing his screen and taking you through actually the application, the software. We will certainly talk for at least an hour. You're welcome to interrupt at any time. It seems that a good way is to type your question to the public part of the chat. So you're welcome to do that anytime. And I will begin. Okay, so as I said, today I'd first like to cover what is Unitime, then what we understand when we talk about course timetabling, and what it is like to timetable courses with Unitime, how it works. Unitime is a software for comprehensive academic scheduling, or it works as a comprehensive academic scheduling solution. It tries to cover all the needs that the university may have for timetabling. So it has a part, a component for course timetabling, another component for examination timetabling, then student scheduling, and event management. It allows for distributed data entry and timetabling in a multi-user environment. It is an open source software, so that's one of the reasons why it is a part of the Apereo Foundation. It's open sourced and it is for universities. It's written in Java, using modern technologies, using the state-of-the-art optimization algorithms. Unitime was first used at Purdue University in 2005, and this year in 2015 it became an Apereo project after about a one-year-long incubation process. I wonder whether you see the slides okay. I have. Okay.
Hello,
Now it's better. So what do we understand by course timetabling? Actually, in a few words, it's the process of assigning times and rooms to classes. That's simple. We want to create a course timetable that is good for students because the university is there for students to provide education. However, that time and room assignment to classes needs to meet some restrictions and preferences. There are courses, their size, the rooms that they need, the size of rooms, equipment. The courses have different structure. There are instructors who are available only at certain times, and they have some preferences, they have some needs. There are students that can be represented by their plans of study, or the students can register for courses before course timetabling is done. And there is a number of other restrictions and preferences, such as the university has only so many rooms, or the campus is in one place, or the buildings are spread across the city and farther on. And course timetabling is a difficult optimization problem, so it's complex. why would timetabling be needed? And why would anybody look for a tool that helps them timetable? Tools such as Unitime can help minimize student conflicts to help students receive degrees in time. So in other words, the courses for the students should not overlap so that students can study them. It can help use limited resources more effectively. So use the rooms more efficiently. If you have a good tool for timetabling, you might not need to build another classroom, for example. The process can be made more transparent and sustainable. So even within a few years, you have the history how a timetable was created. You don't only have the end results, but you also have a lot of information about the process. So, for example, when a new timetable manager comes, it's easier for him to continue creating a good timetable because they have information from previous semesters. It helps to provide fairness and satisfaction with the timetable. It is more equally unfair to everybody than maybe just a person would be. You can model what-if scenarios. What happens when you don't have a building out of a sudden? What happens if you significantly change the plans of study for the students? And it helps you adapt to changes. So, for example, if you have the change in curricula, or if a room becomes unavailable in the middle of the semester, it can help you adjust with minimum changes to the other lectures and recitations. How is course timetabling done in Unitime? So first, the data needs to be collected. It can be collected either or entered by individual departments. So each of the departments can enter their set of data, or there can be one central person who enters everything, or one central office. The data will be information about rooms, instructors, courses, including the restrictions or requirements, such as this course needs chemistry laboratories, and preferences, such as the instructor prefers to teach in the afternoons. Once the data is in Unitime, a course timetable can be created. There is a range how the solver in Unitime can be used. It can be used for to automatically generate a timetable, or it can be used for manual timetabling too, although it's not recommended. Ideally, it is used to automatically generate a timetable and then then modify it manually. And even after a timetable is published, it's usually necessary to make some modifications. An instructor can leave the university, another instructor teaches at different hours, so it is still necessary to make some changes. And for that, there are tools to manage the courses after timetable is published. So that's the course management part of the process. Now, those were the three parts. Now I will talk about the data entry. So the data, all data needs to be collected before course timetabling takes place. The data will be about courses, instructors, rooms. There can be relations between courses and or classes, such as the classes have to be one after the other, or they have to be on different days, and so on. And there needs to be some information about students. So, for example, the curricula or plans of study or the pre-registrations and such. So now we'll go into data entry in more details. First, the courses in Unitime are represented or have visual representation of their structure. Actually, the term that's used instead of courses in Unitime is instructional offering. In a few seconds, you will understand why. So an instructional offering is in most cases, the same thing as courses, except that you can have, do you see my mouse?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. Except that you can have several course numbers through which you can get to the same classes. So students of the course math 170, students of the course statistics 170 are all in the same lecture, and all of them can be in either lab 1 or lab 2. So in Unitime, these two would be called courses, and the thing that consists of lecture and laboratories is an instructional offering. So when you see instructional offering, in most cases it is the same as a course, except that there are sometimes there are two or more course numbers associated with an instructional offering. There are scheduling subparts. The scheduling subparts indicate the structure of the course, so or of the instructional offering. This instructional offering has some lectures and some laboratories. So one thing is it indicates the structure. Another thing is that you can set up some data together for all the classes of the same scheduling subpart. So these scheduling subparts, those are the parts of the instructional offering. And the smallest unit is a class. So the scheduling subpart lecture has only the class lecture one. The scheduling subpart laboratory consists of laboratory one, laboratory two. And the classes are the most important parts of the instructional offerings, because it is the class that needs to get a room and at a certain time. So the class actually is the group of students that needs to have, that needs to be educated at some location at some time. So class, remember class, we are timetabling actually classes, of course timetabling. That's the courses and the structure. For each class, we need to know a lot of things to find correct rooms and times for that class. So the first part is we need to have information about possible times when the class can be taught. That information consists of two parts. First, it is the weeks of instruction. So in this example, there are, you can have classes the whole semester, which is all weeks, or you can have just even weeks, odd weeks, or just 1 week in the semester. It is like used up by indicating in a calendar which weeks that given date pattern has. That's the weeks of instructions. Then you have time patterns. The time patterns indicate possible times within 1 week. So the week when the class is taught, the time pattern tells you at what times it is possible. And you can indicate not only when it is possible, which is like right is prohibited, but you can also indicate which times are preferred or not preferred. The scale is the same for all the preferences that you will find throughout unit time, from required, the blue color, to prohibited. Required and prohibited are strict restrictions. They have to be respected in the timetable. So when in this case Thursdays are prohibited, the class cannot absolutely be taught on Thursdays. Then from dark green to dark orange, there's the scale for preferred. That's information used during the optimization of the timetable. So for this, that doesn't have to be met necessarily. Those were the time preferences. Now we need information about rooms, about correct rooms for the class. First thing is, Unitime needs to have good information about the list of rooms, about the rooms that can be used. For that, each department has a set of rooms. Even on the rooms, not necessarily related to particular classes, there can be information about the availability of the rooms or what departments can use the room. So if you have a room shared by several departments, you can indicate that on some days the room is not available at all for course timetabling. That may be like the dean's meeting or external classes, like there may be language school or something. So the room may not be available for course timetabling at all on certain days or times, or it can be available only for a certain department at certain times, or it can be available for everybody. Those are the white times. So there's a list of rooms and the availability and sharing of the rooms. Then it is important that the students, if they have two classes that are one after another, it is important that the students can make it from one class to another. So if the rooms are too far apart, it's not quite possible. If, for example, the students have to, it takes half an hour to get from one class to another and you have 10 minutes break, the students cannot get it there. So we need some information about the distances of the rooms. We can take either room coordinates or it's possible to set up travel times, how long it takes to get from one location to the other. So the classes cannot be immediately back to back if it takes too long to get there, to get to the locations. For the purpose of setting the possible rooms for a class, that was the list of rooms and how it can be managed. To set room preferences on a class, one of the things you need to know is the minimum room size for the class. Like, what's the smallest room the class can be in? Usually, that's taken from the limit on the class. How many students can get in? It's usually how big room you need. Then there are room preferences. Preferences can be set for a particular room or building, or you can create room groups. For example, in this case, in this example, the room group is classroom. You can have a room group for computer rooms. Or here is a departmental room group, geology classroom. Again, there is a scale. You can use it from required to prohibited, but also on the level of preferred or strongly preferred. Or you can select a room or prefer a room based on the features of the rooms. So there are different ways how you can set up preferences or requirements for a room. You don't always need to list rooms for all the classes. So we covered times, we covered rooms. Now there are relationships between classes. Those can be set up by distribution preferences. So, for example, you can require the classes to be back-to-back. In that case, for example, there are the distances checked, whether the students and the instructors can make it. You can require classes to be in the same room or to be taught on same days or meet together. As an example, you have two classes that are actually in the same room at the same time. So you have to tell Unitime it's allowed. Otherwise, of course, you cannot have instructions in the same room at the same time. And there are more of them. There's a long list. You can look at the demo later and see the descriptions of the preferences. You can set those distribution preferences either between individual classes, or you can set it on the scheduling subpart level. It is also possible to set up these preferences on instructor. We will cover instructors in a minute. Instructors. So each department has to set up what instructors teach for that department. So each department has a list available. Of course, an instructor can teach at more than one department. Then Unitime checks that the classes of the instructor don't overlap even between those departments. And it's done through external ID that can be set up on the instructor. Each department can set up preferences for the instructor, including when the instructor is available to teach. So we have instructor availability and instructor preferences. Again, the preferences can be for time, but there can also be preferences for room or for distribution. It's not so easy to see here in the example. But I won't be able to move it. I will. Okay, so this is an example of instructor's preferences. These are the times that the instructor prefers. There can be room group preferences. This instructor prohibits two of the buildings. Actually, it is the scheduling manager who sets up the preferences. So the scheduling or timetable schedule manager, when the person sets up preferences for the instructors, he or she can enter that for this instructor it's prohibited that he or she teaches in these two buildings. Then there's interactive blackboard, piano. For distribution, it is strongly preferred that this instructor does not teach more than 5 hours a day. So you can set it up on the instructor too. And now we'll get to the part where all the preferences are combined, because they can be set up on scheduling subparts, on instructors, on classes. The preferences are combined in the way that for a class, you either set preferences on the scheduling subpart and on the instructor, and here is the combination. Or, and nothing is on the class. You have on the subpart, you have on the instructor, and nothing on the class. Then it's a combination, it's clear. Or you can set up or override the preferences on the class. So for example, here on the laboratory subpart, you have some strongly discouraged mornings, discouraged afternoons, some room information and preferences. And you can go to one of the labs and override the preferences on that particular lab, maybe at preferred times or something. Once you write something on the class, it overrides everything else, and it does not reflect any changes on the subpart or any changes in the instructor's preferences. Class is the final instance. What you put on class is what is used by the solver and what you cannot override from other places. So again, it's oftentimes complicated for users. You have either subpart and instructor, or you override it on the class and don't count on the subpart and instructor. Now, students. I mentioned at the beginning that with Unitime, we want to create a good timetable for students. Unitime does it the way that it tries to prevent student conflicts. A conflict occurs when two classes overlap in time for one student, or when the classes are back to back, but the student cannot make it from one to the other. They are too far away from each other. So both of these are student conflicts. It doesn't necessarily have to be only overlap. It can also be that the student cannot get from one class to the other, the break is too short. The student course demands, like, how do we know what the student takes together, what should not overlap, what would create a conflict? There are different ways how to enter information about students in unit time. The first one is curricula or plans of study. Here is an example of such a plan. There's first semester students who all of them have to be in Algebra 101. All of them, 100% means that all the students in the first semester have to be in Calculus 101. And then there are electives. So 60% of the students take English 101 and 40% of the students take Spanish 101. And it is possible to group the courses in a way that you indicate that students take this or this, but they will not be in both. They can take only one of them. And you can set up groups for that so that the solver knows that these two courses can overlap because they do not have any students in common. So that's just a part of how you can set up curricula in Unitime. Another option how to import student information is to import last year's enrollments. So you know the history, you know the historical data, what the students took together in a previous semester, in a previous like semester, like from spring, you take spring data from the last year, for fall, you take fall data from the last year. This has some advantages, like to know what combinations of courses the students took, but you're missing information about new courses, or it doesn't necessarily copy the mandatory courses the students. It depends on more than one thing and on the policy of the university, but it has advantages and disadvantages. So the second option is last year's enrollments. Or you can have pre-registrations. The students will register for courses. They will indicate what courses they would like to enroll into in the following semester. Then you can create a timetable that will try to meet their wishes or their registrations. So that's another option. It is more precise than last year's enrollments. However, it's important whether you get all the students to register, whether they provide reliable information. It's quite possible that some students will register for many more courses than they can actually enroll into. So that's the students. And that was all about the various parts that you can enter in Unitime. I'd like to stress that it's important to have good input data, because then you can get a good timetable. If you don't have good data, it's much harder to have a good timetable. So for example, if you don't enter preferences, the class can end up anywhere. So it can be in a computing lab while you need a regular classroom with flexible seating, for example. Or if there are too many requirements, strict restrictions, it may not be possible to create a timetable at all, or you may have too many student conflicts. Oh, there's a question whether one can use combinations of course demands, for example, curricula and pre-registrations. Yes, it's possible. We actually use it at Masaryk University. We use exactly a combination of curricula and course demands at one of the colleges. So it's one of the possibilities when you run the solver. If you don't find it, I can send you a link. Please contact me by email. Okay. So we've covered input data. First, we need the input data to be able to create a timetable. So you need all the data that you can have. Only then move on to the solver part. The timetable is created by a constraint-based solver. It can be used everywhere between manual and fully automated. It's a state-of-the-art solver. It's based on extensive research, and the work on the research is published in a number of research papers. And it also won the International Timetabling Competition in 2007. This is just the screenshot is just so that we have a picture in there. It's one that offers how you can modify the timetable manually. Okay, what are we trying to solve? As I mentioned, we want to find times and rooms for classes. So the variable in the model is class. The value for the variable is a placement in time and room. So it is a combination of time and room. And there are constraints, hard and soft. The hard constraints are the things that you cannot adjust. You work with room sizes. You cannot, if you need a room for 20, you cannot squeeze the class into a room for 5. So it's room size, it's the sharing, which department has what time in a room, it's the availability. Also some embedded restrictions. No instructor or room can have two classes at the same time, unless you explicitly allow it as a way around. The requirements and the prohibited times. As I mentioned, the blue and the red, you can see it in the on the scale in this slide. And then there are soft constraints. So there are the preferences on the scale of like from dark green to orange. There are student conflicts. They are just, the student conflicts are just a soft constraint because it's, in most cases, you cannot create a conflict-free timetable. As soon as the students have some optional courses, it's just too complex. And there are also some additional criteria, like if a class can be in a room that fits the number of students, or if it can be in a room three times as big, it's preferable that it is in the room that fits the number of, that is very close to the number of students in the class. Or the instructors, if they teach back-to-back classes, they shouldn't walk too far. There can be in distance. So there's a number of soft constraints that are used in the objective function. I mentioned student conflicts. The first part, that the classes overlap in time, or one class is too far apart from the other one, if they are one after the other. Another case when a student has a conflict, has a problem that the student can take a combination of courses is, well, the first one was the simple one on the left, like these two classes, they overlap. But it can be more complex. For example, the students taking math seem to have a choice between two classes. They have a choice until they need to take statistics. If they take statistics, they can be only here. If there are too many students, not all of them can fit in this lecture, there's a conflict if some of them have to be here. So the conflicts are not only straightforward. What do we do with the solver? So that was a description of the model and the criteria for the optimization function. Now, how to use the solver, how to actually create a timetable. The first step is to check that the problem has a solution at all. In other words, that you can actually fit the classes into the available rooms at the times that are available. So you just take the strict requirements or restrictions, just prohibited, required, and the room sizes, and so on, you ignore, or the solver ignores, preferences, and the solver will try to fit in the classes into the rooms. It does not make any sense to continue to the optimization of the timetable until you have a complete solution, a complete timetable. There are various tools that you can use if there is no complete timetable. There's, for example, the conflict statistics that will tell you what classes have repeatedly been assigned some time in the room and then unassigned because another class needed that room or that at that time. And it helps you identify the causes of the unassignments. Or you can go to a list of not assigned classes, try to assign them manually, see why it's not possible, and so on. So Unitime supports you during that creation of the complete timetable. So you need to debug the input data and create a complete timetable before you get to the next step. The next step is to produce an optimized timetable. So that's, if you look at the demo, that's, for example, the default configuration. It's possible to generate an automated timetable, look at it, realize that, okay, some input data might need to be changed. For example, you were too strict on some instructor's preferences, or you've made a mistake, or you've forgot to enter some other criteria. So you might see the optimized timetable, think you're unhappy with it, change input data, and then create a timetable from scratch. Or you can just save the timetable or leave it in memory. If you realize that you forgot to add some, for example, you forgot to add some room to a room group or something, you can modify the input data, reload the input data, and continue from the timetable that you already have. So you can do either. You can start from scratch again, or you can start from the previous timetable. The screenshot shows the information that you have available about the timetable that is being created all throughout the creation. And the third step is to make manual changes to the timetable. So when you've when the solver has created an optimized timetable and one that you are happy with, you decide you're happy with it, you can save it, you can load it in an interactive configuration, or you can modify it even in the default configuration. But the main thing is you can modify it. So when you have a timetable, you look at it from all different points of view, like the student conflicts. You can look at it from the point of view of meeting the preferences that are put on classes. You might want to make some modifications. I don't remember a case when someone just took the timetable they got from Unitime and published it and no changes happened ever. So you can modify it, and Unitime supports you throughout the modifications. For example, here's a screenshot. If you know you need to change a room of a class, you can click on the class. You will see options where to move it. So it offers you different times rooms. It even offers you changes that involve other classes. It's not only like if you have some room available, but also if you can swap with another class, even if you can swap like in three steps. It provides you information about what student conflicts you would create and so on. You can play with it on the demo too. The configurations are open to the system administrator, and the system administrator can tweak parameters if it's needed. I would recommend to contact us if there is something you want to achieve. because the parameters usually influence one another. So there's a trade-off. If you increase weight on something, you might need to increase or decrease weight of something else too. So now making changes. You have a good timetable, you saved it, but you want to modify it. There are a few ways. There's set up the minimum perturbation mode of the solver. This is something that you use this mode and you run the solver again. So Unitime makes changes for you. This is good when you need massive changes. So for example, if you lose a room, you want to get as close to the previous timetable or to published timetable as possible, but you need to move the classes somewhere. So something may need to be changed. But MPP mode means you're trying to be as close to the original solution as possible with the modified input data. Then the other option, as I mentioned, you can use the interactive configuration. This configuration even allows you to break some constraints. So a usage for breaking the constraints is, for example, an instructor calls that there needs to be a modification and that actually the times that he said were prohibited are not so prohibited, that actually Thursday 8 a.m., which was prohibited, is much better than the allowed Wednesday 6 p.m. So he wants to put the class into a prohibited time. The interactive configuration allows that. Even in this configuration, the solver provides suggestions, but it's up to you to confirm the changes or to select which change should happen. MPP, if you have MPP, the solver makes the changes. If you have interactive configuration, that just supports manual changes, your manual modifications. And when the timetable is published, you can even modify the timetable without touching the solver. You don't have to load the data into the solver. You can just change time and room of a class outside the solver. Just there's a button from the class detail screen. And it doesn't have the checks for everything. So it's assumed that these changes are that someone who requests the change has thought it through and it's you can make the change, that you don't have to explore all the students' conflicts or instructor availability. So it's just really after the fact when the people requesting the change are sure they know what they do. Unitime, there can be cooperation between several departments on the timetable. So, as I said, data can be entered by different departments, and also the timetable can be created by different departments. And these departments can cooperate. There are solver groups defined in Unitime. A solver group can create a timetable for a group of courses. Solver groups are connected to departments. So a solver group can have one or more departments. The committed solutions of other problems are used as basis. So if one department has published the timetable, has committed the timetable, the other departments will see the timetable and will know that the rooms are not available. So once there is a solution committed, the other departments build on top of that. It can also be used the way that the problems can be solved together at first, which gives you the best results. And then each department can tweak the timetable a bit just within their set of courses and classes. There's also the institution of externally managed classes. For example, I would give an example from Purdue. The classes that require large lecture rooms are solved separately at the beginning of timetabling. So each department that needs a large room indicates that room should be timetabled together with large lecture room class with other large lecture room classes, and gives that class to an external manager, or passes it over to an external manager for timetabling. Or at Masaryk University, some classes are passed on to the combined to the for timetabling as a separate problem for the distance learning. So the distance learning classes are passed on as a separate problem. So they're passed on to a different manager to create separate timetable for distance learning. These externally managed classes can have a completely different set of rooms than the regular departments have. They can be timetabled before or after the departmental problems, or in between. It's just another solver group that can be solved. It's besides large lecture rooms, it's computing labs, or at Purdue they have a set of classes that need additional rooms on top of what each department has available for timetabling. So, publishing the timetable. The timetable, when it is committed, it means that other timetables can be built on top of that. It doesn't necessarily mean that everybody can see the timetable. But there's, if you change the status of the session, you can change it to a status that allows, for example, instructors or students to log into Unitime and see their personal schedules, or for instructors to see their personal timetables. The students can see timetables of rooms or timetables of curricula. So that's publishing in Unitime. When you publish the timetable, the steps that usually follow are that the timetable is then exported to a different system. So it can also happen that the instructors or departmental managers check the final timetable in Unitime. They ask for modifications, if any of them are needed. And then the timetable is exported to an external system when, for example, the students can register for can enroll into classes. Or you don't need to export the timetable to a different system. You can continue by creating schedules of classes in Unitime. That's the other component of Unitime. I mentioned Unitime as component for course timetabling, for student scheduling, examination timetabling, or event management. So you can do student scheduling once you have a course timetable. You can create schedules for individual students in Unitime. Then you can also schedule timetable examinations, or it's also possible to manage events in Unitime so that people know where when rooms are available to book for various activities, or if you need to move a class, you have information about other events taking place in the rooms. So it's all in one place, both for course timetabling and for requesting rooms for events. Okay. And then there's course management. Like at first I mentioned it as the part once you publish timetable. But here I like to mention the life cycle of a course timetable. So the management of the whole process. If we put it on a timeline, first there's data entry. And Unitime, you set up the semester by combining data from previous term in Unitime. So once you set up your courses for fall, for example, for fall 2015, you can reuse the data for fall 2016. So when you have all the structure of the courses, the preferences, even the instructors who usually teach the courses, you can reuse the data, you can roll it forward to the next semester. You can combine that with importing data from external systems. For example, you can import curricula from another system in which you manage the course catalogs and related things, related information. Then, okay, thanks. Thanks for the warning. And yeah. If you follow the chat, Neil gave us 10-minute warning if we want the presentation for an hour. But I would like to ask you, maybe you can put it on the chat now, whether you would like to continue with a demo of Unitime, because the presentation is almost over. So if you want to continue with a demonstration of Unitime, please mention it on the chat. If there are at least 3 people interested, I think we can continue a little longer if you want to. So I will finish faster. Then you have automated timetabling. So you create a timetable. You adjust it a bit because the solver doesn't give you a perfect timetable, so there are usual manual adjustments. Then the timetable is published, you still get requests for adjustments. Then you can schedule students in Unitime. There are additional changes because you always have changes. And even after classes begin, you still may have some requests for changes. Then classes end, but you already started preparation for the next semester. So you roll forward data from the previous like semester, and again, you have data entry and so on and so on. Okay, there are 2 people voting for the demo so far. So is there anyone else? Here's, okay, there can be some hands. You can click on some hand and you vote that way. I didn't notice before. Okay, 3. Neil, is it okay if it's longer? Is it a problem with recording? No problem. Okay, thank you. So, thank you. So we'll continue with the demo, which will be on the instance of the data is based vaguely on College of Education at the Masaryk University, which is a college with 6,000 students, where and data is entered by 24 departments. And they have distributed data entry, so the departments enter input data, but there is only one person who creates a timetable on top of all the data. Distance learning is timetabled separately. That's that externally managed set of classes. It was data for a workshop, so for the set of data, for the workshop set of data, the timetabling has been decentralized. So what you will see is several departments. Okay, thank you, Neil. Thanks. So for the workshop, the timetabling has been decentralized. They have shared resources, especially rooms. That's why the timetabling is done centrally. And they take students information from curricula. And Tomáš will now give a presentation or will share his screen and show you the data on demo.unitime.org/workshop. You will have the workshop data available for a week or two after this webinar to see, like you can click through that. You can see the accounts, how they are set up. So you can log on as a user 001 and with this password and so on. And you have access only as departmental schedule managers. So you can log on and see after we finish the webinar. And that's all I wanted to say. So we've covered data entry and the solver. We can talk about more things, of course. But if you want to discuss further things, please let us know in an email what topics you would be interested in. We can have more webinars than this one. And we also answer questions by email. So you can go to the website or you can propose topics. And now I would like to pass the presenter's part to Tomáš. Thank you.
Okay, hello. Let me just start the screen sharing. We had some issues when we were trying this out before, so I hope it works now. So you should start seeing my screen just about now. So I'll just shortly go through the items that Zuzana was talking about and maybe show one or two things. So essentially, this is how the Unitime user interface looks like for a schedule manager. So it's usually just the courses they are concerned about or the courses part of the menu. Maybe I can start with those things that you need to enter first, like there needs to be some rooms. So for here, I picked a user, which a schedule manager, which is for the Department of Geography. So I can see the rooms that the classes of the geography department can be put in. And there is actually a lot of classrooms that are quite of common classrooms in this problem that are being shared between all the departments, which is what you can see here. And there are some specialized rooms at the bottom, some labs. What's important here, I think, besides of each room having a capacity and some location, it's also that there could be some features, room features and room groups defined. And you can actually use these groups and features in the timetabling. Like you can say, I need a room that has a computer, that has a microphone, or you can say, okay, I need a distance learning classroom. And it will filter out the rooms that are available to just those that has that feature or that room group, or you can just prefer a feature and so on. You can also, for each room, we can have some, we call this a room availability matrix, where we say, okay, this room is being shared between these departments, and you can actually go in and also say, okay, and this particular time is only available to the Department of Geography, whereas some other time is only available to some other department. But since this is a general classroom, it's available for grabs for all the departments. And actually, the problem, even in this setup, and each department can run its own solver, since all the classes or most of them are happening in these classrooms, I would guess the initial run of the solver would have to be done together with all the problems. Otherwise, they would just, at the time you start committing each of the problems, they would start having problems of using the same room at the same time. So I think that's for the rooms. Besides of the rooms, I'm concerned about instructors. This is the people that are going to teach my classes. And as Zuzana already mentioned, and each instructor can have some preferences set on him. So I can have preferences on time. I can know where the instructor is not available, where he's available, where he's preferred to be teaching. You can have some limitations, some preferences on rooms or or buildings, like if there is a room he needs to teach, or if we know that he needs a special equipment, we can prefer that feature right away. And there could be also some distribution preferences, like I cannot teach more than 6 hours a day, or yeah, there's a bunch that could be used. So that's the list of instructors. And let me go ahead and go to the instructional offering. So this is actually the courses. And as I said, that I'm as a department of geography that will be offered for this semester, which is spring 2015. And yeah, I can see how they are set up, and you can probably go in and set up a new course. That may be the nicest way to show you how this is done. So let's create a course. Let's say we create a geography 999 course, which would be a geography for other majors. There is some additional information we can put in, but let's just skip that for now. And we have a course, and we need to create at least one configuration which says like how the course is going to be offered. And let's say that we will have 60 students, up to 60 students in this course, and it will have a lecture and a recitation. The recitation would have a limit of 30 students, so there would be two of them, and let's say we have 10 students per recitation. And let's say both of them would be 90 minutes. And I can either set it like this, which essentially means that there are two lectures and 6 recitations, and the student can go either way. They can take any combination of a lecture and a recitation. The other thing I can do as well is in that configuration that I can nest the recitation under the lecture, which means, let me just update it so we can see it on the classes, that if I as a student, if I take recitation 1, 2, or 3, I had to go for lecture 1 as well, or if I go to recitation 4, 5, 6, I had to take lecture 2. So I can somehow link those together. So I have a configuration now. I need to put at least some preferences in. So the bare minimum I need to set up is on each subpart, I need to select a time pattern. A time pattern is a way of saying how the course will be offered. So we have created 90 hours, 90 minutes a week class, which is like 2 45-minute hours. So I'm selecting a 2 45-minute hours time pattern, which in this case means it has to be taught on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, or Friday for 2 hours. And it can start at 7:30 and end at 9:10 or at 8:25 and at 10:05 and so on. And there is actually currently there are 2 time preferences available. The second one is actually for distance study, because at this college what they do is the present form of study they teach Monday to Thursday, the ordinary students, and the distance study, the learning continuous education and all these other ones, it's Friday or Saturday. And what actually happens is that the students of the distant learning, they come, I don't know, every other weekend, either for Friday or for Saturday, and just have a bunch of classes together, and then they come in 14 weeks, and we will not go into that detail. But after the presentation, you can go in and you can look at how the distance study is set up as well. So let's just say it's 2 hours, Monday to Thursday, and I'll do the same for the recitation subpart. Update. So if I go back to the offering, I can see now I have just 2 hour time pattern. And since I already have preferences on instructors, the next step what I can do is just assign instructors. So let me check what I had in there before. Like I can see all the instructors. And I had the other one on the other section. So actually, it's set in a way that you either get a lecture and a recitation taught by Amelia, or you get a lecture and a recitation taught by Ashley. And you can see the minute I have done that, that there are some preferences that have been taken from the instructor. And maybe one more thing I can do is, for instance, go to the lecture subpart and say, okay, the lecture has to be on Monday, so I can just require Monday. And as Zuzana already said, the preferences, we use the same schema across Unitime. It goes from required to prohibited. If something is required, it has to be at that time. If it's prohibited, it cannot absolutely be at that time. And the middle ones are the soft constraints. We try to satisfy, or the solver tries to satisfy as many as possible of those. And if I would put a room preference, it has the same schema. It's going from required to prohibited. But yeah, just put the required Monday to show you, because on time preferences, it's actually quite nice. You can see that the preferences got combined. So I'm requiring Monday here. The instructor she cannot teach at 7:30, but has some preferences Monday through Friday. But since the class had to be on Monday, it got cut off. So it's only Monday is now preferred. So it got combined in a way that satisfies both constraints, the one on the subpart and the one on the instructor. And the other thing I can actually do is also set up a distribution preference saying that the lecture always had to be before recitation. So I can just go to the subpart and click on add distribution preference, say precedence, constraint, I'll do the progressive and tell you in a minute what that means. And it will be on a lecture and a recitation, actually all of them. And if a progressive constraint is set like this, it doesn't create one constraint, but it creates one constraint per every pair of classes that follow the subpart. So there will be one constraint that lecture one has to be before recitation one, another constraint saying that lecture one has to be before recitation two, another constraint that lecture one has to be before recitation three, and the same for the lecture two and the recitation four to six. And if you look at the constraint, there are different structures, and you can always see what that means. And there is also a help page that can give you even more details. Well, not really in this. Well, there is the subpage describing them a little more. So now when I have created this course and I have a bunch of others that have been already in there, let me try the solver. So as Zuzana mentioned, it's under courses. This is all related to entering input data, and this is all related to the creating of a timetable. So I'm going to course timetabling solver first. And I loaded the problem, and I can use the check configuration first, and actually just hit the start button, which means it will load the data into the solver, run the solver with the configuration, and finish at some point, or I can stop the solver. And whenever the solver is up to something, that you can see the status in here, it says loading input data. And if you hover over it with your mouse, you can see what it's actually doing. So now it's loading room availabilities, and it will do a few more phases. And then when it's done with loading, it will start solving. Eventually. In the current setup, we have how many? I think 15 departments there, and each already has a committed timetable, which means it goes over them and actually marks in those rooms what times are not available because they are already committed in some other department. And I would hope it would be finished already. Okay, it's solving the problem now and searching for initial solution, and it stopped. And I can see that it all the variables are assigned, all the classes have been assigned. So yeah, I have a complete solution. If I did not have a complete solution, I could go to not assigned classes and look at them, or go to the conflict statistics and see where the solver was struggling the most. So essentially the statistics tells me, like, whenever there is a class that got bumped out of some place because of some other class, there is a counter gets increased. So I can see that there was an unassignment of this class and it was unassigned from this particular placement because of a constraint, either the instructor or the room and some other assignment, or I can see it based on the constraints. So I can see the most struggles have been with this Amelia Burns instructor. Like, I think it it just had a little hard time, but not that hard. It's just 70 unassignments. But yeah, if there is a hard conflict, if it cannot find a complete schedule because the problem is over constrained, you would see much higher numbers there, because it was just essentially, that's also the reason why you need to run the check configuration first, because if it's not able to find a complete solution, it will just keep on trying to find a complete solution, try to extend the existing partial solution, and it will keep on failing, and it will just keep on increasing these counters for some constraints, and yeah, it would not really get to the optimization as much. So we have a complete solution, so I can unload it and use the default configuration and start again. Or I can load. When it's loaded, I can hit the start button. So it's loading again. So while it's loading and solving, one thing I haven't shown you from the input data that Susanna was talking about are the curricula. So it's one of the ways how you can get in student information, and this is usually the easiest one to enter, because you can do everything in Unitime. Whereas yeah, if you have last like historic enrollments, or if you have pre-registration, you can also do in Unitime, but you need students to actually fill in the courses they want somewhere, either in Unitime or in an external system. Here for a curriculum, I'm just setting together, saying, okay, this is actually a fairly easy curriculum. I have just 3 years, and first year all the students will take these 5 courses, the second year they can take these 7 courses, and the third year they take these 3. That sounds a more complex curriculum design as well. And this is actually a combined curriculum, because it's evolution education and they teach so this is and unmute. So is it better now? It's better. Okay, so I can continue. So that was just a short look at the curricula, and go back to the solver. So now it's already loaded the data in, and it's solving Maybe while it is solving, I can talk a little bit about what you can see on this page. So besides of some configuration parameters, you can see how good is the solution. It's just some such statistics. So you can see how well the time preferences are met. They are actually not that well, but it's mostly because they have been randomly generated. So how many students conflicts there are. And they are actually split. The committed student conflicts are student conflicts between my courses and the courses of some other program that has been already committed. How the room preferences are met, how the distribution preferences are met. One thing, these preferences, this is only those that are soft constraints, like the strongly preferred, discourage, or strongly discourage. All those that are marked as required or prohibited have to be absolutely satisfied. So in some, and yeah, a few others. So let's just stop the survey. It's a tiny program, only 48 classes. One thing, if I stop the solver like this, the other thing I should probably run is the student sectioning. This is essentially just trying to swap students around in the alternative classes to minimize the student conflicts a little more. So yeah, I had 65 before, now it went down to 11. Like in that course we were setting up, there were two lectures and six recitations. So it's possible that the students were left in a section that had a conflict because of some reason. So now when it shuffle the students around a little bit, it's a better timetable. Well, it's the timetable is the same, but there are a little less conflict. And actually, yeah, what you can see here besides of the committed is this is the distant conflicts. There are currently none, but this is the case when the students can actually take the classes, because these classes are, well, they cannot take the classes are back to back or close to each other, but the distance between the rooms where those two classes were assigned is as such that the students cannot, the distance is too great for them to be able to travel from one room to the other. So it's not, the classes are not overlapping, but well, they are in locations that are too far apart. The hard conflict is just a marking. It's essentially the student conflicts that are in classes that cannot be shuffled away. And it's mostly used for the solver, because the student scheduling is done in a way that when the student data are loaded, the students are sectioned, assigned to classes somehow. And during the search, it does not move them, it doesn't shuffle them around. But so it's better to have a little higher weight on those that cannot be shuffled away, where you know that some percentage of those that are not marked as hard because could be shuffled away. So there is a lower weight on those. So yeah, that was for that. So now I have a timetable, so I can look at it. And there is a couple of pages. There is the time grid where I can see all the rooms and the classes in them. Actually, those that are gray, the classes that are of different problems. So there should be some geography classes somewhere, like here. Those are in there, and I can also, what I can do is also display instructor schedules, and I can also change the way it's displayed, or I can actually use some background colors. So for instance, let me show you how the time preferences are met. So here I have, for each instructor, I can see how his or her classes are marked, and they are actually quite good because they are in strongly preferred or preferred times. So yeah, you can look at that. You can even look at how the curricula are stacking up, what those students are going to take each day. I can look at the classes that have been assigned, that if there are some classes that are not assigned, I can look at that. But since all of them are assigned, I can go here. So let's see how that geography 999 did. So I have two classes, both of them are Mondays, they required, and all those other ones are afterwards. But let's say I want to take this Monday class and move it to some other time. So let's take the last slot on Monday. You can see, okay, if I want to move the Monday class to later slot. That is the recitation 5 that has to be after the lecture because of the distribution preference we put in there. So it would become unassigned, and that is actually the lecture 1 or some other course, some other class is in at that room at that time. So if I do this assignment, it would bump two other classes out, or I can try to get some suggestions for them. And it didn't provide it, it didn't found any suggestions that would move just two classes away, but there is a suggestion with three of them. So you can see that, yeah, it's possible to move my class to keep it in B5 room, but move it to 6:30. So which one is it? Oh, did I select it? But okay, and it will, besides of moving my lecture to 6:30, it will also move the lecture 1 from that slot to an hour earlier, and it will move the recitation to actually a later slot at 7:25, and some, yeah, actually it's a different course. And the recitation 5 that cannot be on Monday anymore got to Wednesday. And I can, if I'm fine with that, I can just assign it, or I can look at other suggestions. They are ordered by how big impact they will make in the for the solver. It's the score which is a weighted sum, all those criteria I've been showing you, like the time preferences, room preferences, student conflicts, distribution preferences, and such. And so, okay, let's just make this assignment, and now it's the last slot on Monday. And actually, yeah, if I like this schedule, I can just go in and save it. So now it's saving the solution. And one thing I would like to show you, because when you are working with the solver from the solver page, it's you are working with two solutions. This is the solution that the solver found during the search as the best one. This is the score. This is the weighted sum of all those criteria that are listed below, and the current one, which it keeps on changing. So if I go in and stop the solver and make some change, it actually makes the change to the current timetable. So the other option is that once I have a timetable and yeah, it's no longer loaded, I can go to the saved timetables, which, yeah, there could be multiple. And actually, this is the old one that we had before and that had been committed, and this is the one that I have just saved, and I can commit this one instead of the other one. So now this one is the one that would be used and seen and worked with for the other solvers. But the other thing I can do as well is from here is to load the interactive solver. It's the same solver, the configuration is different. And one of the biggest differences there is that it's now that the solver is allowed to break some of the preference, some of the constraints. For instance, if there is a prohibited time or required time or room, it can avoid those. But as Zuzana already mentioned, the solver will never break the constraint. You have to actually manually consciously pick that in that suggestion screen. So okay, it's loading a room availability again. It seems to be taking some time here. Oh, is there something else I haven't spoken about much? Well, yeah, I'll cover this. Over. So maybe it's loaded now. So if I go in and it's using the same pages, so I can use the timetable grid or assigned classes, not assigned classes, but there are none, because they have a complete schedule. But for instance, what could happen is that you make some change in the input data. Let's say if I were in and, for instance, prohibit Monday on that geography course, if I have now out of sudden decided, okay, I don't like Monday that well and it needs to be on Tuesday, if I did that and then went to the safe timetables and loaded the data into the solver, it would keep some of the classes unassigned because they no longer meet the requirements. And in that case, I can go to the not assigned classes and assign them. So let's just try to make some change. So back to the lecture two, and now I can see, you can see that besides of the class, the times that are preferred and discouraged for the class, that I can actually go in and select a Tuesday class. So let's say, okay, it has to be at, yeah, the instructor doesn't like the Monday evening, but is fine with Tuesday morning. So let's try Tuesday 9:20, and I have a problem because the room is not available. So yeah, I would have to go in and check. So let's try some different one. Also, I'm lazy. Yeah, that's one of the constraints you cannot break, is that the room is being used by some other class, like this there is a biology class at that 5. So let's see what's in B5. Timetable grid. Room. B5. Yeah, there is only an hour. No, nothing on Tuesday, so let's find some other room. No Tuesday. Yeah, the rooms are quite dense. Oh, it's a smaller room, but it should allow me to do that in the interactive. So 5A. So if I go back to my assigned classes, or I can do it from there, but I would have to find that class first and say, okay, I want, was it? And you can see those are not only prohibited, but they are too small, so they are also crossed. So B58 at, what was it, Tuesday morning. So I can do it, and I actually doesn't have any problems with that. So I now have the class someplace else, but well, whenever I open it, it will provide me suggestions that would actually fix it in some way. And can I get the suggestion for Tuesday? I just keep time and try to find a different room. No. But okay, I think you get the picture, I hope. But yeah, you can actually, it's quite useful because you can play around and you may or may not do an assignment, so can select the time, see some conflicts or not. In this particular, it's let's just pick a suggestion out of a bunch. But essentially, you can combine that. You can either try to assign the class manually, or you can pick a suggestion, or you can select a time and a room for one class and continue with the other. So let's say I like this big swap and do an assignment. I've done that to show you some other pages. So Yes, I'm working with the interactive solver. I can see the changes, and this is essentially comparing what I have done so far towards like what was the initial solution, or I can just, this is the solution that is selected on this saved timetables page. So if I select my the old one, there should be a lot of changes because yeah, my solution was completely solved by, from scratch. So yeah, you can see that a lot of things got moved around, and I did not have the geography 999 in that first solution, so it's all new in there. The other thing I can see is the changes. So what? No, not the changes, the history. So as I am working with the solver, I can see this a timestamp what I have done, and I can even go in and if I click on a suggestion on a line, it will provide me with a suggestion that would undo that change. But of course, since there could have been some other changes afterwards, it selects those assignments as an undo, and it could show me that there are some additional conflicts because something else got moved already. But I can go in and let's say they undo this assignment into that small room and prohibited time, and it appears there as an undo. Well, the conflict statistics I have talked a little bit about, so overall it's just shows what it's up to, including the manual changes. And lastly, there are some reports you can use from the solution, like you can see how the rooms are being used, what are the student conflicts. And in this case, I can only see what has been my perturbation, what are the things that I have changed. But like if there are any distribution preferences violated, there would be a section with them as well and the others. So if I go back to the save timetable, say I loaded the solution, I can now go in and either save it as the current one or save it as a new one, or I can save it and commit it right away. Well, actually it was committed, so I can save and commit again, or save it as new and commit the new one right away. So as you can see, I can with the course timetable, I can work with multiple solutions, but at the end, there is one solution being committed, and that's the one that will get used for other stuff, for student scheduling, for publishing, for the events. So it's now saved. And when I go to save timetables, I can see that there should be a new one. Let me unload this one. Doesn't want to show it for some reason. I don't know. Well, anyway, for the rest, I think the only other thing I would like to show you is how the events looks like. This is essentially an interface that could be used by anyone at the university. By this, what I have shown you before, that's for the schedule managers and administrators and such who are creating the timetable. The events interface is for people that are looking at timetable, that could be students, instructors. So I can see, for instance, this events timetable, and I can see a timetable of a particular room, for instance. So yeah, I can see what's in a room. I can even do some additional filtering of that, or I can just say, okay, I need any classroom that's of at least 50 spaces. You can see, you can also just either type it in or put it into the filter. And well, all I have in here are class events. So let's say, okay, I'm only interested on Monday. So now I can see Monday in those rooms. If I pick a room, I can see just the Monday in one of the room or of them. And besides of a room timetable, I can also see a timetable for a subject area. So let's see what I was looking at with geography. So this is the classes for the geography department, or let's say just the 999 course. So we have two lectures there and a bunch of recitations. Or that we can see a curriculum or well department. It's in this case it's the same because my geography department has just one subject area. You can also see a timetable of a particular person, but since we don't have any students in, I should probably be able to only to show instructors. Okay, this is one of the I've been using, so you can see what's the schedule of an instructor here. And it's either in a grade or as an event or as particular meetings. And this interface could be eventually used to create other events as well, not just have classes in there, but that I guess is for a different webinar. So I think I'm done with the presentation. Zuzana, do you want to continue, or I think we just ask for questions now?
Yeah, I think we can just have questions, or then you can send us by email what topics you would like to cover in next webinar or what you are interested in.
I can see that there was a question whether it's possible to assign two instructors to a class. Yes, that's possible. It's possible to assign as many instructors as you want. And even in that 999 assign instructors, there is, you can see those plus buttons. So I can add another instructor here and there could be more of them. And it's also possible to say, okay, but this is not a true instructor. It's just someone that needs to be listed on a class, which I can indicate by not checking the conflict. So like a typical use case is that sometimes you may want to list the professor on recitations, but the professor is not actually teaching those classes. So you don't want the server to make sure that the professor is available during the recitations because there is just too many of them.
I think Matej wanted to have a question, or?
Yes, can I have a question?
Yes.
Two things. We don't have this check configuration for the solver. Do we need to install the check configuration?
It's helpful.
It's useful. I can show you, it's essentially a very simple configuration. If you go to administration solver configurations, this is the check. It's pretty much everything is default, but like when you have the solver comparator weights, all the weights are set to zero. So there are all the soft criteria are ignored in the solver weights and in the placement selection as well. And that's it. It's the rest is the default. So essentially, that's one way to do that would be to just go in and create that configuration if you don't have it already. And I think the only other difference is that it said so that the solver stops the minute it has a complete solution. So it doesn't go all the way through all the 300 seconds in this case.
All the 5 minutes, yeah.
It doesn't rhyme for all the 5 minutes.
We have it, but we never use it.
Okay.
It's you can use the default configuration or the configuration you have with the same purpose to run it first to make sure that you have a complete schedule. The reason to use the check configuration is that if you cannot find a complete schedule, this way you make sure that you cannot find it because the program is over constrained. And the conflict statistic look also a little better because it doesn't bother of trying to assign a class to preferred time first before it starts a discouraged time. It just assigns a time. So most of the stuff you can see up in the list are the problems.
Another question. During your demo, you change the input data to unload the class, right? And did you reload the solution, or it was already in memory and was changed in the memory?
if I make any change in the input data, I have to reload the data into server. I have actually, we're only talking about that, I haven't actually made the change.
Okay, so you are talking about the change, but you haven't made it, yeah.
So, yeah, the way around it, if I go back to that user, I don't think he has the... The other thing is, which I haven't realized at the time when I was talking about it, because I had an interactive configuration, it would not unassign those classes, because it's possible with the interactive configuration to assign a class into a prohibited time. But let's say if I had the solver in the default configuration, and let's say I just load the committed one, and when it gets loaded, I can make the change. And you would have to hit the reload button there.
Okay.
The reload input data. Because it would not know about it. So if I go in and say okay. Let's say okay, Tuesday is now the day I want. It's still loading, but it's in a transaction, so it will not pick it up, so I would have to reload it again. But once I reload it, it should have those two lectures unassigned it.
Okay.
And I would have to go in and either make the change manually or run the solver again, but at this point, if the timetable is published or more or less you are fine with what you have seen, but just this course, yeah, it's better just to make the change. So, okay, so now everything is assigned. So if I reload again, it will essentially, if you do the reload, what it does, it reloads the input data, essentially all the solver data, but on top of that, it tries to make the assignments that you had before in memory and for the solver. And yeah, it will fail to do that for that for those two lectures of the Geography 999 course. And yeah, there should be a message about it as well.
What we have when reloading input data is sometimes time consuming, and we want to make a small change. And then we have to reload all input data. So it was, if it's possible to change the input data in the memory, it would be nice.
Yeah, that's unfortunately pretty hard to do because the solver works with, like for instance, in the database, you have things like room preferences, room group preferences, room feature preferences, room building preferences and such. What the solver has in memory is just placements. So it has just rooms with essentially the domain of a class saying, okay, this class could be in these five rooms and the preference for assigning this room is this number, which is essentially combined from those. So it would be possible, but it's kind of hard. And I think one of the reason why we actually did the interactive solver is to help you avoid doing that too often. Like at the time when you need to make just a small change, if you need to assign a class into prohibited time or room and to already have the data loaded into the interactive solver, you don't have to change the input data. It's just when the room is occupied or when there is I think distribution preferences cannot be violated. So it got loaded, and you can see that it failed to assign those two lectures, and also complained that yeah, those times are no longer available for them. But if I go into not assigned classes, I can see the two lectures, and it should give me suggestions. So yeah, I can put this lecture on Tuesday, and well, bump some other one into Monday instead. So let's do that. And for the other one, yeah, it just found the time on Tuesday afternoon. So now they are assigned. So I can see that all of them are in there. And if I look at the changes, yeah, they got changed. But yeah, it doesn't show me here what was the previous times because they are no longer in the domain. But if I went to the saved, why am I seeing the committed? It's there. Okay, but if I select another one, it should show me the changes with the selected solution. So I can see, okay, these two got moved from this one and no, these two got moved from Monday to Tuesday, and that is that other change I've done. So, okay, I hope I answered the question. Are there any other questions?
Doesn't seem so.
Right there. So if that's all, thank you for joining us for this webinar.
Thank you.
And hopefully we will see each other on another webinar or somewhere else. Or you send us an email with a question.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks for coming to the webinar. Thanks for participating.
It's always a pleasure. Okay.
Okay. I think we'll just stop recording and leave the room.
Yeah.
Okay. So looking forward to talking to you again. Bye.